The court considers that, with regard to the present situation, Israel must, in accordance with its obligations under the Genocide Convention, in relation to Palestinians in Gaza, take all measures within its power to prevent the commission of all acts within the scope of Article 2 of the Convention, in particular, A, killing groups members of the group, B, causing serious bodily or mental harm to members of the group, C, deliberately inflicting on the group conditions of life calculated to bring about its physical destruction in whole or in part, and D, imposing measures intended to prevent births within the group.
Today, we finally got at least an interim judgment from the UN's International Court of Justice, wherein they ordered, as you saw the beginning of there, and we'll dive into the details, Israel to take all measures to prevent death, destruction, and any acts of genocide from happening inside of Gaza, while at the same time ordering Hamas to release any remaining hostages. That's what they did. What they did not do was specifically call for a ceasefire, nor did they dismiss the case going forward. This is, after all, the interim report. A full analysis of what has happened inside of Gaza could take months at the very least, if not years. Israel had asked for that to be dismissed. The ICJ has refused to do that. So what we have is just this interim report that basically lays out areas where Israel is expected to refrain from doing certain sorts of things, while also coming back in a month's time with a report on how they have complied with that. So we want to give you a little bit more of the specific judgments. And so we're going to turn to more from the president of the court, Joan Donahue. And we're going to have some of the specific rulings. Take a look at this.
The court further considers that Israel must ensure with immediate effect that its military forces do not commit any of the aforementioned acts. The court is also of the view that Israel must take measures within its power to prevent and punish the direct and public incitement to commit genocide in relation to the members of the Palestinian group in the Gaza Strip. The court further considers that Israel must take immediate and effective measures to enable the provision of urgently needed basic services and humanitarian assistance to address the adverse conditions of life faced by Palestinians in the Gaza Strip. Israel must also take effective measures to prevent the destruction and ensure the preservation of evidence related to allegations of acts within the scope of Article 2 and Article 3 of the Genocide Convention against members of the Palestinian group in the Gaza Strip.
So you saw there a listing of some of these provisional measures. They were approved by a wide majority of judges, if not unanimously, with two of them being 16-1 and four of them being 15-2. And so some things being ordered for Israel to comply with and come back in a month and report on. Other steps that the ICJ theoretically could have taken, they did not go so far as to take. So I want to start off, Yaz, I'm going to go to you first. What do you make of this? Is this in line with what you might have expected the ICJ would do?
Unfortunately, yes. And I feel like I say that a lot, that this is not surprising. I really wish sometimes that I would be surprised that something good would come from things like this. I think this in particular, people were really holding out hope that the UN would come through and do the right thing and say the right thing, and they really didn't. And you mentioned when you were talking earlier, you said that this actual investigation could take months or years. We don't have that kind of time. We've seen what has already happened in the weeks, in the months since October 7th. We've already seen how many thousands and thousands of Palestinians have been killed indiscriminately. And how many thousands and thousands of children specifically have been killed. And now we're seeing images of Israeli protesters blocking aid trucks from getting to people in Gaza. So it's really, really disheartening. It kind of is difficult to wrap your head around the idea of what that area could look like in a few months from now, because we've already seen how much destruction has happened in just a few months.
Yeah, I'll back up, get on that as well. So first of all, as we all know, it's such a volatile subject. I have, as a stand-up comedian, I have fans that are Jewish, I have fans that are Palestinian, I have friends that are Jewish, friends that are Palestinian. And I always say, I go, of course, they always say, do you condemn the actions of Hamas on October 7th? Of course, that was an atrocious act. But then that doesn't mean I cannot then continue to also say, what's been happening in Gaza is also atrocious, what we're seeing, because yes, we are supporting the right of Israel to defend itself, but at the same time, when we see the destruction and the humanitarian situation that's going on in Gaza right now, as a human being, you go, well, let's call for a ceasefire, let's step back. Because by the way, there's different opinions on how you help get the hostages back. Maybe by calling for a ceasefire, you get a chance to get the hostages back. Some of the hostages that came back happened during a ceasefire. And I was talking to this person who happened to be a general, American general at some event I was at, and he made a good point. He goes, you know, war is political, but once it becomes personal, once you kill my brother or my relative, then it's no longer political. It's harder to get out of it. So I understand when you see some of my Jewish friends, like when I've said ceasefire, they'll say you're anti-Semitic. I go, I'm not anti-Semitic. I'm just saying ceasefire because there's people dying on the other side, and we're dehumanizing. Both sides will try to dehumanize the other side so that the killing of the other side is okay, and that's not okay. And so, you know, as Yasmin was saying, I would hope that we could all come and call for a ceasefire and stop this continuous destruction that's happening.
You know, both of you sort of have alluded to theoretically what the ICJ could have done. They could have specifically called for a ceasefire, which they have not done, in the same way that they did not declare this to be a genocide or not. Basically, what we're left with is a lot of the things they're saying that you can draw implications from. I mean, they did not call for a ceasefire, but they have called for certain behaviors to not happen. They're not to be widespread death and those sorts of things. In theory, it would be difficult to accomplish all of what the ICJ has laid out without something significantly approaching a ceasefire. But it really will come down to what extent does anyone feel like they must be bound by even these provisional judgments. So in theory, most states do have to comply with what the ICJ says. In this particular case, both South Africa and Israel, they have to follow the court's orders because they are party to the 1948 Genocide Convention. But we also know that it is the court of the UN. So in theory, if there wasn't compliance, it could eventually come down to a vote in the Security Council, in which case the US has been very free with the veto power in the past. And it's not even like that would be the first time that a state hasn't complied with what the ICJ has called for. In the, you know, the relatively early stages of the invasion of Ukraine, there were also calls from the ICJ for Russia to pull back from what they were doing, and they just haven't done that. So, and the issue is the UN isn't going to invade Russia. So we really have to see how much is it worth that there is this, that there are these provisional judgments. Will they be complied with in a month when the report comes due? You know, how much compliance will there be, or will they just be stymied in their attempt to get that? We will have to wait and see. For now, I do want to give you some of the reactions to this. So the national security minister of Israel was the first Israeli official to react to the judgment, tweeting Hague Schmeg. And honestly, I'm gonna put that one on the tab of Donald Trump, because I feel like he's really done a lot to normalize juvenile social media responses to judicial decisions that don't go your way. So maybe we shouldn't be that surprised that that's how government officials are starting to respond to stuff like this. But taking it a little bit more seriously, you have Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, who reacted to what you saw with this.
Like every country, Israel has an inherent right to defend itself. The vile attempt to deny Israel this fundamental right is blatant discrimination against the Jewish state, and it was justly rejected. The charge of genocide leveled against Israel is not only false, it's outrageous, and decent people everywhere should reject it.
So the issue is that while much of what he said could be interpreted as true, when he says that the ICJ rejected the charge of genocide, that is just not true. They also didn't confirm it. They did not decide on that. As we said, we could be waiting years to find out about that. So to come out and put out a video claiming that that has been rebutted is simply, that's just not what the ICJ actually did. Finally, defense minister for Israel, who had previously called for a total siege of Gaza as part of a battle against what he called human animals, which by the way, that was cited in this case, said that the ICJ had granted, quote, South Africa's anti-Semitic request. So again, I mean, the ICJ did not agree with South Africa that it is genocide. All they have said is, here are a list of things that you cannot do. There can't be widespread death, you have to provision aid, you have to prosecute incitement to genocide, those sorts of things, which I think most serious actors would say every conflict should be adjudicated in that fashion. But again, this is a guy who had previously called Palestinians human animals, so I don't know what expectations we would have of him. In any event, Maz, I want to start with you. Any reaction to what you've seen?
Yeah, you know, the question becomes, at what point does Israel consider victory? Because they're saying they need to completely destroy Hamas. And the fact is, in that process, a lot of innocent Palestinians have died. And also, you're not winning hearts and minds. It's getting worse and worse. I actually fear for a lot of my Jewish friends, because I see the rise of anti-Semitism because of the actions of the state over there. And so the question becomes, how do we come out of this with a solution? Because the fact is, there's several million Palestinians there, there's several million Jews there, and neither one is going anywhere. So as a world, we need to come together with a political solution and give the people of Palestine their own autonomy, give the people of Israel their own security, and I hope and imagine a world where they could live side by side and they could prosper in their own worlds. And I think that we are not currently on the road to that, with this current bombardment and continuation of killing of innocent people there in Gaza. So I don't know where we're headed, but I would hope at some point that the other powers, the world powers, would get together and say, we need to come up with a political solution, and a military solution never solves this problem.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think what we're seeing now play out, it kind of was a long time coming, and it's hard to imagine a world where we didn't end up in this place, right? You look at things, whenever you look at these conflicts similar to this one, right? Throughout history, things that were basically created by foreign powers, you know, the UK, the US, whoever, they put these things in place, and then decades later, after things fester, they always blow up this way, and it never works out well for the people involved, the people who are actually living in those spaces. And so after the flare up, since October 7th, let's say, right? Even though we know that this has been going on for decades before that, what always bothers me about these types of things, you know, especially with what we saw from the ICJ earlier today, what always bothers me is that we're here in the West, right? I'm sitting in this room, in this house, I'm very safe, I'm very comfortable, and we're over here in the West, in the so-called civilized world, and we're spending months debating everything from history to the Bible to political strategy and economic theory. And while we're over here arguing semantics, trying to decide if the deliberate and indiscriminate killing of thousands of Palestinians and thousands of children technically meets the definition of genocide, people in the East are dying. You know, children are dying. And it's so very frustrating, and you can't blame people for being impatient. Because every day we're all seeing the same things. We're all seeing how bad the destruction is over there. All anybody wants is for the violence to stop, and they want for the children to stop dying. And this, I think a lot of people had a lot of hope that there would be a ceasefire called, and it isn't here. And we are getting impatient, and it's very hard to witness.
Yeah, and patience is long patience in this case. If you're really invested in what they're eventually gonna rule after years, I mean, that is going to matter at the time, but that is worlds away at this point, and they potentially could have gone stronger. They did not. I did see earlier today that Joe Biden had apparently told the Israeli government that he wasn't in it for a 1-year conflict, I think is the quote that they said. Okay, that's something. In the meantime, the conflict is now 4 months old. More than 26,000 Palestinians have died. That is more than 1% of the population of Gaza, which, I'm not a mathematician, but if I do some quick mental horror math, is like in 4 months, more than 3 times bigger of an effect on their population than COVID was on the US over the course of 4 years. So absolutely devastating situation, still in its infancy. We could be in this for a year or two, and God only knows you know, how much violence, how much suffering there will be through the course of that. But of course, we will be following it, as the vast majority of people around the globe, I think, should and will.
Thanks for watching the video, guys. We also love it if you hit the join button below, because that makes you a member, and members allow us to be independent, honest. We could be as progressive as we want, no corporate media influence, and that's all because of you guys. We love doing the show with our members. Hit the join button, become one of the Young Turks.